So in today's session, we will have two talks by Irena on uniform Artin-Rees lemma, continuing from the last time. So Irena, you may begin now.
Okay. All right. Thank you. All right. So our goal is to prove the weak version of the uniform Artin-Rees lemma. So I'm restating a few things that we did last time. We don't know all the conditions under which the weak or the strong version hold. In my notes, I wrote up a few strong version, uniform strong versions. It's not necessarily true for all ideals, but when you restrict ideals to maximal ideals or to principal ideals, then that has been proved. What we did for our weak version, for the weak version, we already made some reductions. We don't have to worry about all ideals. It suffices to prove it for the primary, for ideals that are primary to a maximal ideal. That would not be good enough for a strong version. That the inclusions just don't go the same way. So a strong version is a very different kind of animal. So anyway, our goal is to prove, I'm trying to show one screen, no. Okay, so these are right here. Why isn't this working? There, okay. So if we want to prove, we cannot possibly prove all three parts in all the detail because that would be much too much, but I will make some indications. Another thing that we've reduced to last time is we had this wish definition. We related this uniform Martin-Rees lemma, or we made a digression that we could just prove that we have this analytic unramifiers that are not zero. So there exist elements that multiply the nth power of the integral closure of an ideal into just the ordinary n minus kth power. There exists one k that works for all ideals that are all n, that would be t sub k of r. And so the first goal today is to prove, so this is when is t of r not zero. Okay. So no, we haven't yet proved the weak uniform Artin-Rees lemma, but we're making a distraction, which is actually an important ingredient for the proof, as well as I think it's of interest of its own kind. So first of all, for t of r to be non-zero, r needs to be reduced. And the reason is that if it's not reduced, all integral closures always contain the nil radical of the ring, but ordinary powers do not contain the nil radical. In fact, high powers do not contain it at all. So we really need the ring to be reduced. So the theorem that we'll try to prove, so let R be a reduced Noetherian ring. Of characteristic P, then T of R is not zero if any of these conditions happen. So the first one is R has a test element, and the curl dimension of R is finite. So I do not know if there exist Noetherian rings of characteristic P that have a test element but are infinite dimensional. There might be a theorem of that form, but I'm not sure. So I am imposing this finite dimensionality right now. In the next cases, R is finitely generated over an excellent a local ring, so Noetherian local ring. We know that such a ring is finite dimensional. Or the third condition, if R is F finite. And it is, if R is F finite, then there's a theorem of Kunz that it has finite dimension. Okay, so both of these two imply the dimension of R is finite. And then the other thing that's also true, conditions 2 and 3 imply that R has a test element. The proof for part 3 was already given by Kevin Tucker. This was theorem 7. I also wrote it up in the notes. And the proof of that in case 2 R is finitely generated over an excellent local ring, but then you have a test element, that is a lot of pages, many of the 14-page section 6 in Hunig and Hochster paper, the first one, the first big one. So I cannot possibly justify this. So take 2 and 3 somebody would have to check the proof, but I'm not doing it today. So what essentially I have to do is, this is all I have to prove. I've reduced to the proof of only part 1. Okay. And the rest is by previous work by various people. Okay. So we have a test element and we have a finite dimensional ring. So, the first thing is, and one thing I in my notes, I just 15 minutes before my lecture, I realized I need a little bit more work. So the first thing to do is step 1. We can assume, suppose that there exists a K. In fact, actually, we will not prove that K is 2D, where D is dimension. So D D is the dimension of the ring. Suppose there exists K such that for all zero-dimensional ideal, zero-dimensional primary ideals, we have this inclusion I, and for all n bigger than or equal to k, we take the interclosure of I to the n that's contained in I to the n minus k. Then it's, we already proved last time the uniform, the weak uniform Artin-Rees lemma. It suffices to prove it for n primary ideals where n varies over maximal ideals. It's the same kind of proof than what we actually have, that the same holds for all ideals. So that means that T sub K of R is actually the whole ring. So one multiplies the interclosure of an arbitrary of the interclosure of the nth power of an arbitrary ideal into n minus k power of that ideal. Okay, so that is, I'm leaving that. Step 2 step two is we need to find some kind of reduction of I, so that we will have a uniform D. So the first thing is by prime avoidance. So now we only have to prove it for let I be M primary, arbitrary M primary, where M is a maximal ideal. And now we want to find some kind of reduction of I. So first of all, by prime avoidance, and here for prime avoidance, I don't need M primary at all. This would work for any ideal. There exists a D plus one generated ideal J containing I such that the radical of I equals the radical of J. So this is just prime avoidance, and I will assume that you have seen something like this. I will leave it as an exercise. By the way, the exercises, there are perhaps too many exercises. I just added a few which haven't been uploaded, but I'm also saying don't do all of them. And I write what I think of exercises. Good for the soul. So for this, we don't need the M primary ideal. What we need for M primary ideal is that now we can localize, after localization at M, then I is M primary after localization. And if we know that the ideal is, if we know that the residue field is infinite, then we can find the degenerated reduction. But I didn't assume that the residue field is infinite. So there's a little bit more work. And so here I will also leave it as an exercise we have that the integral closure. Sorry, I don't understand why this happens sometimes. I must be touching something. Okay, here, this is on this side. And on this side. What? Did I delete it? Oh! I started a new note. Okay. All right. By an exercise, what we have is that if we take the integral closure right to the end, so this is locally, that's contained in the tight closure. I guess I should do it locally. Tight closure after localization, N minus D. And even though the dimension of R localized at M might be smaller, but it's at most D. So this D works. So this is the usual Brienson-Skoda theorem. So we know this, Ian talked about the Brienson-Skoda theorem, and it works whether you have an infinite residue field or not, because you can first pass to the infinite residue field. So it's again, one of those tricks. Okay, so now when we lift to R, I didn't need this at all. When we lift it to R, then the integral closure of then the integral closure of I to the N, well, we know that tight closure does not commute with localization, but it does commute with localization for all M primary ideals. There's only primary ideals, primary to maximal ideals. Okay, so actually, either I made a mistake right now, I discovered this only after a gap. So maybe I don't need this at all. Not needed. Anyway, so we have the integral closure of I to the n is contained in the tight closure of I to the n minus d. And then what we did assume is that R has a test element. Undo. And undo again. So we have a test element. This is true for all n. And so now this is final step. Let C be a test element. Then C times I to the integral closure, C times integral closure I to the n is containing C times the integral closure n minus d to the tight closure of this power, but C is a test element, so this is just in I to the n minus d power. Okay. All right, so now if we go back here, what I said in this side, I have to correct. So we didn't prove, we didn't quite prove this in step one. We just proved that there is C times I to the integral closure is in I to the n minus k. And so then we can conclude that for some non-zero C. And then all we know that this here is also not zero. So a little bit of back and forth. If we know that this T sub K of R is not zero when we only restrict to M primary ideals, then it's not zero for otherwise. Okay, so C is in this T sub D, so T sub D of R. And if I go back here, undo. Here, I was also wrong on this side here. Where did I say it was just D? Okay. All right, actually D minus one. So that proves this T of R is not zero. And then I want to state another theorem. And this one, again, we cannot prove. This is due to Lippmann and Sate. And it's quite restrictive. I write the statement in 4.2 in the notes. And so the previous theorem, the previous pages, we started with the reduced ring of characteristic P. Lippmann and Sate as handles characteristic zero. So let R be a regular domain with infinite residue fields. And whose field of fractions has characteristic zero. It's not saying that R contains a field of characteristic zero. It has a field of fractions as characteristic zero. And then T of S is not zero for any finitely generated R algebra S that is that contains R and has finite curl dimension. So a proof of this Lippmann-Sate theorem, the T of S is not zero, this would take us a while as well. So Lippmann-Sate proved some other things, but then Hunick approved, plus Hunick, the T of S is not zero in this case. Okay. So this is this ingredient that we stumbled upon last time, and now we need another ingredient that will help us prove the uniform Artin-Rees lemma. Okay, so these are now, we do new section, co-qualifiers. That's not an official name, but obviously it was meant. So this was, first we need the definition. So we start with the complex. It has F0, F1, F2, and it stops. So we have F sub T, and then zero. So this is a complex of finitely generated free modules. So each of the capital F, I should call these G sub I. So the Fs are finitely generated free modules and the Gs are maps in the complex. So we know what the rank of a free module is. I guess R is over the ring R. So we know what the rank of a free module is. How about the rank of a map? So if you have a free module Rn of Rm, and we have a map here, R module homomorphism. This is the maximum of R such that the, we can think of G as a matrix. So if we take the ideal of R by R minors of this matrix, that is not zero. So this is rank of a map. And we say that there are two things. The complex F satisfies standard conditions on rank if, first of all, over here at this T spot, the rank of F sub T is the rank of G sub T. And everywhere else, the rank of G sub I plus the rank of G sub I plus one is exactly the rank of F sub I. So this, if we had vector spaces here, this is exactly exactness of a complex. But we don't have vector space of fields, R is in general not a field. And then we say that F satisfies standard condition on height if the height of the ideal at rank of G sub I. So the ideal of maximal possible minors of G sub I that don't give us the zero ideal. So this by definition is a non-zero ideal. If height of this is at least I. You might have seen F satisfy standard condition of, on depth if the depth of these ideals is bigger than or equal to I. So if R is co-Macaulay, then height is the same as rank. So we have, this would be an exactness a criterion. But then the second part of the, or the next definition is under these conditions, we say that the set CM of R, call them co-qualifiers of R, this is the set of all elements X in R such that so it's the set of all elements X in R, such that for all complexes F satisfying standard rank and height conditions, C kills, this X kills all the homologies. This is zero for all I bigger than or equal to one, of course. So in a Cole-Macaulay ring, one would be an element of this Cole-Macaulay, this ideal, this is actually an ideal, it's not hard to see. So in a Cole-Macaulay ring, this ideal would contain one, but in general, it may not be so big. Okay, and I will start this, the next theorem now, but I will be able to finish the proof only after the break. So here is our lemma, it's the lemma. Lemma. Let R be an Noetherian ring. Let P be a prime ideal in R, let C be an element of the ring not in P, such that its image in R mod P is in the Cole-Macaulifier of R mod P. So let J be any ideal generated by A1, so D elements. And what we want is the height of this ideal when we go mod P is at least D. And suppose that there exists an integer k such that for all n, j to the n intersected with p plus cr is containing j to the n minus k times p plus cr. So in other words, what we're saying that at least for this ideal J, we have uniform Artin-Rees for the module M is the whole ring and N is the ideal P plus CR. And the conclusion is that then we have, at least for this J, we have the uniform Artin-Rees also for P with the same K. So my iPad is showing, is it 9:31 or is it 9:41?
31.
How much?
31.
Oh, okay. Oh, so my iPad is showing the wrong time. Okay. All right. So I have plenty of time to prove this. All right. Proof. Let's start. What do we have to show? Well, this is certainly contained in P plus CR. Let's make it equal. It's equal to this if I also intersect with P. And then by assumption, this is containing J to the N minus K, P plus CR, intersect with P. Now, by the same trick we've done several times, this is J to the N minus K, P plus j to the n minus k c intersected with p. But this ideal here, I don't hurt anything if I write intersected with C. It is already in C. So this here is J to the N minus K P plus C times J to the N minus K. This here is just C times P, right? Because P is a prime ideal and C is not contained in it. So we can factor C out. So we're left with this. So what we have to show C, I have to erase this bar so you don't see it's not integral closure. I had it underlined. So we have to show is that C multiplies J to the N minus K intersect with P into the J N minus K P. So this is where the Kolmogorov qualifiers come in. So C is a Kolmogorov qualifier mod P. So we can just show that now we have some complex of finitely generated free R modules free R mod P modules. So we need R mod P modules that satisfy the standard rank and height conditions. And that here is J N minus K intersect with P, J N minus K P. Is this equal to H sub I of some F of satisfying standard rank and height conditions? So this is the question. And that's the goal so when we do that, then we'll be done. Yeah. So let's see. So proof of this that it's actually true. So now let's start with complex, and I'll call the maps. Maybe I should call them G. No. So F's get map G's, and G's get map H's. Let this be a minimal homogeneous free resolution of the ideal generated by the nth power of the ideal generated by d variables in the polynomial ring, so t is generated over the integers by x1 through xd. So there are many ways of producing such a resolution, and take, for example, the Egan-Northcott resolution. That's another thing that you might have seen it. If not, if anybody knows more recent references, like Brunstetter, have a pretty nice proof, but there might be another one. I have seen, not in print, some other nicer proofs. So if you know a nicer proof and you want to type it up, that'd be great. You can include it, or you put it in your next expositor book. And so what we know is, at least for this Egan-Northcott resolution, we know that if we take the ideal of, so for each of the maps, so if we take the ideal of maximal minors, so I omit writing that this is the ideal of maximal minors, it's just implicit that it is the ideal of maximal minors. So we know that this ideal, at least up to radical, it's equal to x1 through xd. So that's what makes this Egan-Northcott resolution very powerful. And so now let F be the advantage of this ring T is that it maps to every ring, in particular it maps to our R. So not R mod P, but R. Well, it could also map to R mod P, but we're tensing with R, and the map is that X sub I, of course, goes to our A sub I's. So A sub I's, J is this ideal generated by the A's. So this is F. And so what we do is now we compare. So on top we have G, on bottom we have F. So all I have to really write is there's R, the Egan-Northcott resolution, I should have said of R mod. So here is R to the N plus, wait. We're doing F here. This is F, so I already tensored, and D minus one, choose D minus one. And here, whatever it is, let's just call it F2. We will need more details than this. And then, so this is F. We don't know if F is an exact complex. We know that because the A's are unlikely a regular sequence. So this is not necessarily an exact complex, but down on the bottom, we will have a similar thing, but H here in this row is a free resolution of R mod J to the N. Okay. So, and here we have H sub two. Again, it doesn't matter what the rest are. Now these two are equal, and whatever the map here is, we have the same map here, and we call it G1. It's the same map. And this bottom thing, H is an exact complex, and F is a free complex. And whenever you have a free complex going, well, at least the start, we have here a start of the map from one complex to the other, we know that there exists a map going down here that makes everything commute. So at least we have a map from F2 to H2. So now we really need something mod P because C is a column, a qualifier mod P. So tensor with R mod P. And what do we get? So F tensored R mod P, and at least the start of the map, R mod P. What we have is we have a surjective map. This map is a surjection, at least in the second spot. So this is zero. This is one in the first spot. So we have a surjection. I should do a different color. No, this is color. We have surjection after tensoring with armor key. I should just do it here. So we have its identity here, but surjection on the homologies. So we have H1 of F tensored R mod P surjects onto H1 G, sorry, H tensored R mod P. So we have a surjection. But what is happening with this thing here? This thing here is still is a complex of finitely generated free modules, free R mod P modules. And the height condition holds. So the radicals of all the tensored maps, before tensoring, the radical contained all of, all the X's. So now after passing to R, the radical contains all the A's. And so now it still contains all the A's. But these are the radicals in R mod P. So we have the standard height conditions are satisfied. Height condition is satisfied. But also the rank condition and rank conditions are also satisfied because they were satisfied by the original Egan-Northcott complex. And the maps didn't go to zero, and the ranks stay the same. Okay, so what that says, thus C kills this homology of the tensored F. So this is zero, but we have this surjective map here. And by the surjection, C also kills this. This is the red complex. That's also zero. So what we have to figure out, what is this homology here? But this is exactly J to the N intersected with P over J to the N P. So that requires a little bit of work. All right, so let's go back to where did we start? So what we have on this side, we have to show this. Well, we showed it for all powers of n. So we conclude that J to the n intersect with P, we follow through over here. This is contained in J to the n minus KP plus C times J to the n minus K intersected with P. But we just now proved that this is in J to the N minus KP. And that does it. So let's go back to what we proved. So remember, on Monday, we had some cases where if we had some kind of reductions mod P, and I call them J there too, we had some kind of reductions mod P, and if we can get a good handle on them, then we get some leverage on other ideals, or at least M primary ideals. So here, this lemma really gives us that leverage. And by the previous section on trying to find T of R is non-zero, so if we know that T of R mod P is not zero, and that these Coulomb qualifiers of R mod P are not zero, and if we can do this for all primes P, then we are in pretty good shape for being able to prove the uniform Artin-Rees lemma. Okay, so the next section would be, when is this Coulomb qualifier is not zero? When is C of M of R not zero? So that's the other big question. And for the T of R to not be zero, remember we needed a reduced ring. For the Coulomb qualifiers, we don't need reduced rings. And the next section, section six in the notes, has quite a few results where it is not zero. I give fairly complete proofs of where the Coulomb qualifiers are not zero, but I would probably skip that part. It's kind of technical. I want to get to the juicy part in the next section, is when can we prove the uniform Artin-Rees lemma? Okay, are there any questions? Okay, well then we can take a break now.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, we'll meet after 10 minutes.
Yeah, okay. All right, see you.
Yeah.